My name is Scott Pedowitz. I am the chair of the Committee 100 this year. I really do want to welcome everybody here to our program members and guests, where we will be discussing the question, how will Arlington deal with school attendance boundary changes? How will Arlington deal with school attendance boundary changes? And this is the second time this program year we are discussing how to educate and where to educate our students. Back in October, we addressed the question, where will today's elementary kids go to high school? And we had a lively conversation with Superintendent Pat Murphy, Chris Ditta from the County Council of PTAs, and School Board Vice Chair Barbara Cannon. And we looked not only about the wheres, but the hows, what high school will look like in the next decade, and where our young kids as they get older will be educated as we have space and educational need changes there. Now, that discussion looked a lot to the future. But whilst we were waiting on that, our school board has been attending to more proximate and pressing issues in reviewing the geographic boundaries for our existing high school programs. And their recent action on that back in December has been the cause of much conversation in the community and sets the stage for future discussions on elementary and middle schools. So for those unaware, on the 1st of December, our school board passed a change to the boundaries for our three comprehensive high schools. The reason for this was that Washington Lee was forecast to have about 600 more students than either Wakefield or Yorktown in the near future, and the goal was to balance this out. And I'm sure if I'm missing any of these details, Nancy will correct as we go on. The change, though technical, was not without controversy. And I'll let our speakers address the decision-making process in more detail than I can, because they're much more acquainted with it. But among the concerns raised with members of our community on all sides of the discussion was how well the decision balanced competing priorities of distributing the students and allowing students to attend schools close to home, and also giving our students the experience of attending schools that reflect the full diversity of our community. And addressing this experience and what lessons we can take away from it as a community are going to be very important going forward because, as mentioned, we're going to be discussing boundary issues for elementary and middle school in our not-too-distant future. And so I'm very pleased to welcome two individuals who have contributed a lot to this discussion already. First, we will hear from our chair of the school board, Nancy Van Doren. Nancy was first appointed to the school board in September of 2014 and then elected to the board in her own right twice in the not terribly long amount of time that has passed since then. She has been serving her first term as chair since July. And prior to joining the board, Nancy served as PTA president at Thomas Jefferson Middle School, chair of the Arlington Special Education Advisory Committee, and as a member of the Multimodal Transport and Student Safety Special Committee, the Family and Community Engagement Working Group, the Career Center Parents Advisory Committee, amongst others. But we need to get on with it, so we're going to leave it at that. Nancy also has extensive business and international experience, including living at various points in her life in Serbia, Sweden, Switzerland, Spain, and just for some lexical diversity, Nicaragua. And second, we'll hear from a student at Washington Lee, who is also the online editor of its Cross Sabers newspaper, Matthew Herrity. Matthew's editorial, an open letter to the school board, was published the week after the aforementioned school board decision, and it took the board to task for its decision, questioning whether that decision was consistent with APS's core values. Matthew's letter was widely read in the community and led to much continued discussion about the way to approach these in the future. And if you have not read Matthew's letter and also Nancy's response to the letter that was published the following week, I highly recommend them. They're both available on crosssabers.org, and they really are excellent readings, so I commend them to you. We are very fortunate to have both Nancy and Matthew here with us this evening. And so please join me in welcoming Nancy Van Doren, the chair of the Arlington School Board.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here this evening. It's really a pleasure. This is my first visit with the Committee of 100, and I've really been looking forward to this. Thank you for inviting me. I'm going to put this discussion within the framework of Arlington Public Schools and our mission. I think that's very, very important because boundary decisions are a tool that we use to help us ensure the best possible education for all of our students. So I'm going to frame the discussion and not just talk about boundaries. So I'm going to talk about our mission, vision, and values. I'm going to give you some data, a look at a demographic outlook that's going forward. Diversity at APS, because that is part of the argument that's been had about the boundaries and what we're going to be doing going forward. So where are we? This is our mission and vision for the school system. We are committed to instill a love of learning in our students and prepare them to be responsible and productive global citizens. What I want to stress is that we have that as our mission for every single student in Arlington. And I think everyone in this room needs to be very, very proud that we provide opportunities for success for every single student in Arlington. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. We have core values and strategic plan goals. This is the last year of our current 7-year strategic plan that comes to fruition at the end of this year. We begin writing that again next year. So you'll have an opportunity to provide input over the next year on what that should look like. I do want to point out that diversity is one of our values. We value all students, staff, and families in our diverse, inclusive school communities. And I will talk in a minute about the history of that and how we actually play this out in the day-to-day lives of all of the students and have historically. So we have that mission, we have our values, we have our strategic plan. What has been the result of all of your energies, our energies within the schools? All of our schools are fully accredited. We have one of the top-ranked school systems in the country by many, many measures. I just want to point out, I put at all of your places a summary of our outcomes, and I'm just going to mention a couple of them. We have a 97% graduation rate in our comprehensive high schools. I want to say that a 97% graduation rate. That is one of the ultimate measures that we have on how well we're doing at educating every child that walks into our schools, whenever they walk into our schools, and from whatever background they have. We educate them and they graduate. I want to back up to elementary school because investing in our earliest years gives us the best return on our investment. We are the leader in preschool education. The Virginia Preschool Program, VPI, supports early childhood education, particularly for low-income students. All of our elementary schools now provide foreign language training, which is an essential skill going forward in our economy. What do we get out of that kind of an investment? Close to 80% of our eighth graders complete Algebra 1 and Geometry each year, and over 80% of our students have, at eighth grade, have completed one world language class. They also complete a geography class, which means they enter high school with 3 verified credits towards graduation by the time they leave middle school. Now, what's our high school? On-time graduation rate is 91%. That includes all the additional programs, including Arlington Community High School, which those are adult learners and they take longer. But at the comprehensive high schools, Wakefield, Washington Lee, and Yorktown, it's over 97%. Close to 80% of our students complete one advanced college-level class. 93% go on to post-secondary education, and we are in the top 3 schools nationally on the Washington Post Challenge Index. Thank you. Thank all of you for this investment. Now, I am one to tell the truth and to put all the facts on the table. Do we have work to do? Yes. But if you look at this, we are above the Virginia average, 82%, 87% reading SOLs. And where do we have work to do? This is why I ran for the school board. We have work to do with our students with disabilities and our second language learners. That's our gap. That's what we have to close. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing. That is our gap, second language learners and students with disabilities. And we're gonna do it. I wanted to put up the math. The math is very, very similar. But the matrix here, folks, 50% is here, 100% is at the top. Please notice how close we are to the top with most groups. So where are we going? I've shown you what the job we are that we're doing, and I showed you where our areas of opportunity for growth are. So now we get into numbers. This is, since 2000, our growth. As you can see, we continue to grow. We're over 27,000 students today. We haven't hit that number since 1968. We're above our highest previous level, and it's projected to continue. We just did a demographic analysis with the county. We will land somewhere between 30 and 40,000 students, then we'll plateau. But that's out in 2030 or so, 2035. And where are we in our plans? We have completed our current strategic plan. We finished the high school boundary refinements, which allowed us to equalize the population at the three high schools, which will take us until we open a new high school. We're preparing for the 30,000 students. We will be doing boundary refinements for middle schools and elementary schools in South Arlington next year. That's going to happen. Everybody needs to get used to that. As with that kind of growth, we're going to be constantly going back and equalizing the population in the schools. And part of the reason is we are adding new schools. We will add a new elementary school, a new middle school, and a new high school, 2019-2022. Lots of change. Great schools, great program. The challenge is absorbing that kind of growth and maintaining the kind of outcomes that we have, and we will. Going forward next year, we will have a new strategic plan. We will have a new capital improvement plan, which will build on the previous, and we need to incorporate the Department of Education new profile of a graduate, which is new graduation requirements that are coming. Alrighty, diversity at APS. We have a very diverse population. I think many of you know that and have lived through and taught through the period of change. This sort of gives you in pie charts the various groups that we have. This is an important slide when you talk about boundary changes and diversity and equalizing the schools. This is the change in population and the demographics, the racial demographics in our schools. Please note, the white population, like the counties, continues to increase. The Latino or Hispanic population is slowly decreasing. The black population is decreasing. The Asian population is decreasing. And mixed race is sort of plateauing at 5%. This mirrors the county. We are a boat on the larger sea. This change is happening across the county, and it's happening in our schools. For those of you who enjoy the history, I've included this in your packets in front of you. This is a brief history beginning at our landmark year of the Stratford integration. The top talks about diversity in the schools. The bottom, the opening and closing of schools. I was talking with a couple of people who were responsible for some of those closings, the reopenings. I'm just going to point out a couple of highlights. Stratford is obviously a hallmark for us and our commitment to serving all students. We closed, drew, and dispersed all of the black students in that neighborhood in Arlington View to 23 elementary schools. That did not get rectified until 1985 when we reopened that school and allowed students to go to four schools in that neighborhood. So that's, I'd say, a legacy of busing that we're not really interested in revisiting that period of time. Schools in this period opened and closed. You see the numbers going up and down. 70s Vietnamese population, 80s Bolivian population, that increased our Asian population about 10%. It got to about 15% as a high mark. The Latino population is at 30%, has pretty much stayed there. Throughout all of that, we had a lot of cross-cultural training, courageous conversations. At this point, 3,000 of our students have gone through those courageous, 3,000 of our staff have gone through the cultural competency training. The point I'm making there is, regardless of what school you go in, we have a fabulous faculty that is able to serve every student regardless of their background. To boundaries now. I needed to give you that framework because I believe and we believe that whatever school you walk into, you get the best possible education. Low income status does not predict how you're going to do in our schools because we have great teachers, we have your fabulous investment in the schools and curriculum, we have strong parent engagement programs. All of that allows us to compensate for whatever shortcoming any child might bring to school. So when we look at boundary changes, we look at six criteria and there's no one that's more important than the other. We look at all of them, including, as you know, demographics and promoting diversity. We do take that into account. So in the end, when we did our boundary changes, knowing that we had those six criteria, this is how much our boundary changed. 2016, 2017. It was minimal, and that was intentional. That was purposeful and intentional. It was a very small move. It was fewer than 400 students, less than 5% of the high school students. And in the end, the demographic effect in any group was less than 1%. These are ways you can engage with us going forward. And I'm going back to our mission and vision. Again, this is why I'm committed to the work that I do. We provide an excellent education, thanks to you, your work, and your investment with every single child in Arlington. I'm on this board because I believe we can close the achievement gap. I told you where I believe and we believe our greatest work to do is. It's with students with disabilities and English language learners. Wherever you go, wherever our boundaries are, your students are going to do well. And that's our story, and I'm very proud of it, and you should be too. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Nancy. Now I'd like to invite Matthew Herrity.
Hello, thank you for having me here. So basically what I'm going to talk about tonight is diversity in APS and how redistricting affects that and the options that we have that the community may not know that they have for the future. So to start off, we have to define diversity. What does diversity mean? That's obviously something that the school board is having a conversation on right now. And there's three main ways that I've heard people define it, and that would be racial, socioeconomic, and then mindset / ideology. For the purpose of this presentation, I'm just going to focus on socioeconomic and racial originally, just because there's an abundance of research on it. There's not much research on diversity of the mindsets, and it's much easier to specifically define. First, I'm going to talk about the benefits of integration, and they fall really into two categories. There are purely academic benefits from socioeconomic integration, and then social benefits from racial / ethnic integration. In terms of socioeconomic and its relation to academic, socioeconomically integrated schools can help lower-income students score as much to 2 years ahead as they would have if they went into a higher poverty school. And this was a study done by the New York Times. If you guys want to see it, I can send a link to the Committee of 100. Poverty is more predictive than any other variable of a student's success, and this has been confirmed by multiple sources, which is why I didn't want to list just one, because it was like Stanford, Harvard, the National Council on Education. And then the socioeconomic composition of your school has a larger effect than even your family's socioeconomic status. And this was a study done by Harvard, basically saying that if you come from a lower income family, the socioeconomic composition of your school is more predictive of your success than whether you're in poverty or not. And then lastly, socioeconomic integration is more effective than $2,000 more per student at a given school. And this was a study done by RAND, specifically in Montgomery County. And that's important to include just because when I cite that study, people think it's like a study that's extremely comprehensive, but no, that was just Montgomery County. And then ethnic / racial and their social benefits. There's a study done by the New York Times again, which track the amygdala response. The amygdala is the part of your brain that responds to threat. On white people who were raised in diverse environments, when they saw a black face versus those who were not, and the difference was literally 100% activity versus no activity at all. And this is a study that you can look at on the New York Times again, if you would like me to send it to the Committee of 100. And then you gain cross-cultural skills. It was ranked as the number one trait that employers are looking for by the Harvard Business Review. And then it increases a team's ability to solve problems and your ability to solve problems. That was done by the University of Texas, specifically regarding business problems. And basically, the design of the study was they had different teams, those who were homogenous and those who were diverse. And it was the diverse teams were a lot better at solving those types of problems than the homogenous teams. Furthermore, when we're talking about Arlington, I'm just going to use socioeconomic status, mainly because if you look at socioeconomic status in Arlington specifically, it has almost the exact same effect as looking at race, just because this is the worst graph we have in this presentation. But basically, median income of, well, it's a graph of white households in Arlington. And the orange sliver is 11%. If we assume that all households are a family of six, only 11% of them would qualify for free and reduced lunch. In fact, the biggest cohort, and when they, this is from census data, the biggest cohort, and the cohorts are split up in intervals of 25 and 5, the biggest cohort is those over $200,000 and more. So this, in Arlington, usually socioeconomic status will eventually lead to race just because of the way our county's demographics are. And then a couple of stats about Arlington. Carlin Springs has 37.5 times the free and reduced lunch population of Jamestown. That's purely just numbers, not percentages. Only 30% of elementary schools come within plus or minus 10% of the county's average, 20% to 40%. And then all South Arlington middle schools have doubled the free and reduced lunch population of North Arlington middle schools, despite having at least 24.6% less students. And that is taking the most populous North Arlington middle school and the least populous, most populous South Arlington. I mean, the least populous North Arlington and the most populous South Arlington. And then this is a graph illustrating basically what I was talking about. Those two bars representing plus or minus 10% of the average. Then again with middle schools, then again with high schools, and then a pie chart of the free and reduced lunch composition. The green and purple, obviously, are the two North Arlington schools. And then this one, which I'm just going to stop on because it really shows you how Wakefield, even though they're one school that has a lower population than Washington Lee, almost makes up half of our free and reduced lunch population in Arlington. So the current solution to addressing achievement gaps with regards to economics is Title I. And it gives, basically, nine Arlington schools receive additional funding for additional staffing. If you look, Title I schools have the lowest classroom sizes out of all Arlington schools. High academic standards, they usually have counselors that monitor students' grades closer than they would at other schools. Early and comprehensive intervention, this is basically if a student's behind, they have a team that can help them with that. More family engagement, more professional development to train the teachers to be able to better teach these types of students, and partnerships with the local community. And it's effective. If you look at, this is, the bottom is free and reduced lunch population, Title I schools versus the wealthiest schools, you can see that the free and reduced lunch population at Title I schools scores significantly better than the free and reduced lunch population at the wealthier schools. So Title I does work. However, socioeconomic integration works better. If you look at the free and reduced lunch population, their test scores in the plus or minus 10% of the average, they score on average 10% better than both of the other variables, both of the Title I schools and the less than 20%. And this is three different grades and seven different tests. So it's an average of all of those. It's not just one data set. And then this is basically what the RAND study that I mentioned earlier found. They examined Title I schools versus non-Title I schools in Montgomery County. And they did it through randomly assigning different families to public housing. So it wasn't, they didn't have the testing bias of people selecting themselves to be part of the study. And it basically tested additional resources versus socioeconomic integration. And they found, as I said earlier, basically the same thing that we found, which is that the additional resources, and in their case, it was an extra $2,000 per student, had less effect than just simple integration. And this, the disparities between our schools are most likely going to become worse. And this is a graph that I made basically of the median household income. And then that green, the green boundary you have there is the Stratford walking boundary, and these are our middle schools. And currently currently Williamsburg has 10% free and reduced lunch, except as you can see, when Stratford reopens, they're going to have to take a large margin of that. So with any solution with boundary changes, unless there were going to be buses, it would be very hard not to further stratify the disparities in free and reduced lunch population. Just before I go past the slide, does anyone have any questions about what I'm talking about? Because I know this is really confusing. All right. And obviously it's because in a county like this where we have such a large gradient of income, it's hard to achieve near balance. And that's basically what I just wanted to demonstrate with this slide. And when I talk about this, and I talk about integration, a lot of people immediately think that I'm talking about busing, and I just want to make it clear that I don't want that at all. This is what we did in 1971, and this is the Knock neighborhood, and they sent them to all of the different schools, basically just tearing communities apart, tearing even like apartment buildings and blocks apart, and sending them all over Arlington. And I would be disgusted if something that, I guess, an initiative that I started led to something like this. I don't want to go back to that, and I don't believe that students should pay this price for socioeconomic integration. And then the other slide is just the same map, but for middle schools. The possible solutions are fairness policy, focus schools, Cambridge model, and controlled choice comprehensive boundary changes. I'll go through them very fast. We have the fairness policy, which basically you would just, all of our choice schools would just have socioeconomic affirmative action. The pros is that that's very easy. It's on the current agenda. When they're talking about, right now, the school board's talking about enrollment and transfers. And the drawbacks of this is that they have a version of this at Drew, where a certain amount of seats are reserved for lower income students, and they're having trouble filling them. So this might lead to forcing families to go into schools, which would have the same effect as the flat I showed you earlier. Focus schools, and these are pretty much self-explanatory. You would give each school a focus, and then would open the application. So you'd have like international for Washington Lee, tech for Wakefield, and then let's say language arts for Yorktown. The pros is that it's arguably a better system of learning. I'm not going to go into that because that's not really my place. But the cons is that it's by far more complicated than what we're trying to achieve here. The last would be the Cambridge model, which you eliminate school boundaries, and then everyone applies to their schools. They rank their schools 1 through 3, and then they use an algorithm to assign you to your school, and that factors in a bunch of different variables, and it tries to get each of the schools within plus or minus 10% of the free and reduced lunch average. And when they did this in Cambridge, Massachusetts, 90% of parents got their first choice. And this is just a map of the effects that had in Cambridge, Massachusetts. As you can see, their white population isn't that much different than the state average, so it's not like they're just a superior school system, but they have significantly less achievement gaps. And again, if we were to do this in Arlington, I can't tell you what the effect should be, but I can tell you that the schools that have the composition right now score significantly better. And then, yeah, basically the cons, I don't know how to go back on this, but the pros would basically be that it's we have data on it, and the cons would be it's extremely hard to implement and would take a lot more planning on part of the staff. And I'll just go through the other ones. And what I want to get to is if you want to look at this and all of the boundaries and the walk zones on your own and all the different variables, you can go to this URL, sfdarl.com/research, and you can play around with all the variables if you want to do your own research on this. And then I create a survey if you guys want to tell me what you guys think about these options. And it's just tinyurl.co100arl.
While we fumble with the technology, so we'll begin the questions. We have two people carrying microphones. We have Lynn in the back and Peter here in the front. Procedure for questions, Committee 100, is I'll recognize folks. One of the microphone carriers will come to you. Please wait for the microphones because we do need them for the recording for Arlington Independent Media. Once you get the microphone, please, if you can, stand up, introduce yourself, and ask your question. It is a great Committee of 100 tradition that we hear our speakers and really want to learn from them and from their experience. And so therefore, I ask that everybody please follow the great Committee of 100 tradition and ask your question in the form of a question.
Any luck?
Do you care if I just...
No. All right, we're just gonna turn that off. All right, first question.
Hi, I'm Catherine Scruggs, and I'm a retired teacher with the Arlington Public Schools. I noticed that just yesterday on NPR, there was a talk how the systemic segregation of schools is maintained by individual choices. And so the whole article is about the choice schools and how that leads you back into resegregation. And it's been a concern of mine for quite a while. My question is, even though we're very much aware that neighborhood boundaries is where you're going to find the SES differences, but we do have choice schools and we do have a lot of parents who apply and are on waiting lists, particularly for HB Woodlawn. My question is, why can't we first recruit and admit to a lottery students on free and reduced lunch to make up the 30-31% of free and reduced lunch kids in Arlington? Because our choice schools, really, you have an opportunity there to reflect the community.
Thank you.
So, with regards to the choice schools and having a 30% free and reduced lunch rate, they do something like that with Drew in the Montessori program, except, and you know more about this than I do, but from my understanding is that they're under-enrolled right now. They have like a certain amount of, it's like two-thirds of the seats are reserved for under, I forget the exact number, but for lower-income families. And right now they're having problems filling that amount of reserved seats. So I think the reason APS doesn't do something like that first is because it might force families, if they reserve these amount of seats, it might force families who don't want to go to those schools. And I think the report you're referring to where it says that choice leads to segregation is referring to when you have like a charter school choice, but then you also have a public school, so that the upper income families apply to that charter school and go to that charter school, but then the lower income families just stay at their local school, so it takes out the upper income from those.
That's what we have.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi. We're in the process of reviewing our enrollment and transfer policy in APS. We began, had our second work session on that on Monday evening. One of the questions on the table is whether or not to include this. There is different thinking on the topic among board members. It's an option. It's something that is obviously part of the toolkit that people who believe you have to have absolute diversity at every school believe in. There's a counter argument to that, and that is that we prefer to call them option schools, that those schools are ones in which people choose to go to them, and they should have the option to put their name in the lottery and the option to go to those schools. and that there shouldn't be any one category of student that has preference over another category of students. So we're working through that. You're welcome to weigh in on that. It is a topic under discussion right now with the enrollment and transfer policy.
Before we get to the next question, would you guys like to trade places? I'll take the podium. You guys can sit down here. Yeah, why don't you guys take these two seats? I'll pop up here. Or sit in front. You have the handhelds. All right. Next question. Yeah.
Hi, I'm curious, the population numbers. Do you get them through a census or the amount of students based on what's in school now? In public school.
We work directly with the county on our demographic projections, all of them. We work with the county. We use a variety of different data sources, and we just went through the community facility study and validated the methodology we use to project our population. Some of it is based on the students who are in the school system, but prior to that, I'd have to go through all the different, it has to do with birth rates and in Arlington and the migration in and out of the school system and the trends in that. But as I said, that was validated by outside experts in terms of the method we use to project our population growth. And we just actually had a second round of a consultant report regarding demographics that went out 40 years.
Rosalie Smith Jewell, I am a little confused here because both of you are talking about projections and et cetera, but my understanding is, and I would like you to comment on this, is that with your last boundary change decision, you've made one high school a lot wider than it was. And it seems to me that's the elephant in the room here. Could you comment on that?
We did not change the demographic mix at any of our high schools, but all of them were less than 1% in the change that we made. Our schools across the board are becoming more Caucasian. All of them. Every single school next year will have more Caucasian students, fewer Latino students, and fewer Black students. That's a fact. That's what's going to happen. But that has much more to do with the demographic mix in the county than it has to do with our boundary change. Our boundary change the demographics, that all else taken out, our demographic change had less than a 1% impact on any school.
Yeah, go ahead.
Let me just comment that information is on our website under the boundary change. You can look at it in detail if you'd like to.
Yes, I would just like to clarify on the 1%, and correct me if I'm wrong, when you refer to 1%, you're not referring to 1% change in the numbers population, you're referring to not changing 1%, as in like 6% to 5%, even though 6% to 5% would be a change of 16% change in population.
Right. We are the percentage of the students in any of the three high schools has not changed by more than 1%. I don't know how to say that more simply.
1%.
Thank you.
Hi. The 3 to 5 year plan has 1,300 seats, 1,000 student plus high school program, new high school program, being unveiled or created by 2022. What is this, primarily for Nancy, but also for Matthew, what is your vision for that program? I know we're in the very preliminary stages of evaluating that, but what is your personal vision?
I guess my main focus is just socioeconomic integration, so whatever plan achieves that without significantly harming the population would be the plan that I choose. Looking at the options right now, I think it probably would be better if it was added at the Career Center site, or if it was added at the WNL site as an addition to WNL, not as a single choice school. But I don't really have a voice in.
You have a voice in that. I don't have a preference at this point. We're going through a process of looking at where to locate that school. I do believe, as the community has asked us to maximize the use of our existing facilities, to maximize the use of our existing property, we have to do that because we don't have a way, as often has been said, to build our way out of this growth financially. So we need to really use every dollar we have well. So if we don't have to buy land right now and can place the 1,300 seats, that would be my preference, because I think that frees up money for other schools that we have to build. In terms of the options, on February 15th, the Advisory Council on Instruction and the Facilities Advisory Council are meeting together. The Facilities Advisory Council has been looking at locations. The Advisory Council on Instruction has been looking at instructional programs, and will be looking at sort of a matrix of what the options are. So I just want to make sure we use the resources well, and that we do something that the community can get behind, because we need to fill those 1,300 seats.
Excellent. Sir?
Hello. My name is Nathaniel Green. I'm a guest here. My question has this sort of a follow-up to the question about the demographic changes. I was curious about, you mentioned that the racial demographics really are sort of trending up for whites and then down for racial minorities across the county. I'm curious what factor or factors might be kind of contributing to that overall trend. And if you could speak a little more to, Matthew showed the maps that showed, you know, the concentrations of relative affluence around the community. I was wondering if you could offer a little more insight as to what those trends have been like over a span of time, just to kind of see what's been going on, so we could get a little better sense of where we're at. Thank you.
Well, yeah, I guess I'm not a demographer, but basically the reason the county's getting more white is just housing values. Our housing values are going up really, really fast, and especially in our historically black communities, they're being renovated. Gentrified. they're being gentrified, so you can see slowly that population is moving out. Yeah, we used to have, way back, our black population was 27%, because we had a couple of, when the Freedmen's Bureau still existed, we had a Freedmen's Village here. So we used to have a very high black population, but as kind of the Pike developed, they've moved out. Yeah.
I just want to note that we have a 16-year-old high school student here who has done immense research, and that is, again, a credit to our school system.
Thank you.
We're very, very proud of him, and this is a fantastic conversation for our community to be having as we go through the growth we're going through, because I think it's very important that we, in many ways, hearken back to the futures conversations, and Mary Hines is here and has generously shared her knowledge with me, as have many people who went through that. History repeats itself, and that's something that I've learned here. And it's very good for us, especially as Arlington turns over, that we have so many new people here who don't understand the history, don't understand the structure and the thought that went into the current boundaries, the current programs in the schools that make them the great schools that they are. And I'm not going to add to anything that Matthew said. I think it's the changes in Arlington are economic, they're housing changes, and as I keep saying, our doors open, we take every child that walks in, and we educate them very, very well. So in terms of the housing patterns, that's a larger issue for the county to deal with, and it has to do with the changing economic values in the community.
Katie.
This is a question for you, Nancy. You've already started to answer it. what did the Arlington County Board really think when Matthew wrote his article? I read it when you first published it. Amazing, 16-year-old in Arlington. I was a 16-year-old in Arlington County Public Schools and would have never, ever drawn such attention to this issue that has been throughout all of the generations. My mother and father are both graduates of Arlington County Public Schools, as are many of our neighbors, and this is a topic that has been generations old. So what did the school board really, very impressive.
We were diligent in applying the six criteria when we did our boundary changes. So we were certain that when we had done the job we needed to do to very carefully make those refinements. We were very, very careful about that. We knew that regardless of how careful we will be in any boundary process, you affect people and you affect their children, and it's emotional and it's difficult. And you can take any component of that and criticize it from that micro level. Matthew had his friends who were affected by this, and it caused him to research this closely and deeply and write about it, and we think that that's important. We felt we needed to, though, put that in context, because everybody can write their story from their particular vantage point, and that's constantly going to happen. So while not wanting to be critical, we needed to put it in context, and that's what we've repeatedly done, and we understand it, and as I said, we applaud Matthew for his hard work, but we needed to put that decision at that school in that small group of people in the context of the overall changes that we had to make in terms of the boundaries and our absorbing our changing student population.
The original letter that was written talked about mostly race, and we're not talking about that tonight as much. Is it true, though, that the, as I looked at your maps today, tonight, Matthew, that the Yorktown got redistricted a little bit in the Roslyn area, and Whitefield got redistricted a slice, say, in the middle of the county. Is it true, though, that that community is a black community full of African-American students or not? Is that true or not true?
Well, yes, it's true. A bit of a background on that. It's the highest concentration of African Americans Arlington has, the community that was moved, in terms of block group. And that's because when Hoffman Boston was our all black high school. So that area, Penrose, is a historically black community, and it has our highest concentration of African Americans, because when we were segregated, that was our black high school. So that community is the highest concentration. So, yeah.
So it just happens on the guidelines then that were carefully, the six guidelines, they all boil down to that community, and that community just happens to be an African-American community. Is that true?
Yes.
And, you know, right. Talking
thank you. Nancy, do you want to?
As I mentioned, we're going forward, and that community is changing, and it's one of the difficult components that we have to come to terms with in Arlington, and that our historically black communities are changing and turning over. The largest demographic community in that neighborhood is now Asian. And that's a change. It's a change, and it's a trend that's occurring, and you can look at the demographic changes that are happening the same in Arlington View as they are for the entire county and the school system. I don't remember the numbers. I did look this up before I came, but I'm forgetting. But I did look at that Asian population, because we just had to hire a community liaison person who is from the Mongolian community to serve that increasing population. So it's changing. It's changing.
My name is John Quinn. This is a question for both of you. And it's really to comment on the impression that I have from the presentations that each of you has made. I understand that the school board has the responsibility of representing the entire community. The predominant demographic group is not socioeconomically deprived or low income. As I understand Matthew's presentation, it is the socioeconomically low income group that would most benefit from a more intense integration with the higher income group. And so the emphasis appears to be, from Matthew, on improving their schooling situation. And the question is whether the school board is focusing on improving the school board, the socioeconomically deprived or low-income students so that they would, in fact, benefit from the better integration, or whether you're focusing on the whole community and basically doing what you've said you are doing, which is to educate everybody to the best of their abilities in whatever school they're attending.
I want to be very, very, very clear about this. In Arlington, because of the application of resource, our high quality teachers, our strong family engagement practices, our strong curriculum, being a low income student does not destine you to not do well. We have a 97% graduation rate. So for us in this community at $19,000 a student, we provide a superb education to every student, and every student can succeed. We do not ascribe to the notion that we must put students who are low income with higher income students in order for them to achieve. That is not something that we have invested to make sure that every single school, all of them are accredited, all of them are excellent schools. Every single school is an excellent school in this community. I would put my four children in any school in Arlington, and I hope all of you would too. So the notion that we somehow have these schools that aren't doing as well as those schools, it's just not true. They're all excellent schools. Do children vary in their performance if they've come here this year and are learning a new language? Yes. But I take you back to the fact that out of all those elementary schools and all of those middle schools, we have a 97% graduation rate. That means that they may not score perfectly on that SOL in the third grade, but they do by the time they graduate. So the notion that here in Arlington, at $19,000 a child, we somehow have to take the kids like chess pieces and move them around to do better, we don't. And I have to tell you all something. I grew up with no money at all, none. I was a full scholarship student to Georgetown. I paid for food in my family's home when I was a kid. And the notion that someone who has more money somehow knew more, were smarter than me, and somehow it was going to rub off on me, I have a problem with that, especially in this community where we do so much to redistribute our resources to make sure that what you need, you get. And that's what we do, and that's why I'm so committed to the school system.
Matthew, anything you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, and to clarify, that's something that comes up a lot, and I don't want my message to be misconstrued as lower income families need higher income families to succeed, because we all know that's not true. However, there are factors that aren't in the school, such as PTA funding, that make differences in the schools. Like, I don't know if you saw this, but the Drew PTA was starting a GoFundMe to go to Model UN conference, and I know between strictly Wakefield and Washington Lee, we go to about 8 conferences a year, and Wakefield goes to 2, and our budget is double theirs. And it's not, I don't want my message to be misconstrued as lower income families somehow through their association with higher income families become smarter, because that's ridiculous. But there are factors outside of interaction that lead to that. And the second thing I want to say with regards specifically to the man's question is that and this has been kind of some rhetoric that's been said by my friends and some family members, I don't want to suggest at all that the school board intended specifically to undervalue this community. If you look at our schools like across the nation, they're becoming increasingly segregated with each year, and it's not because school boards undervalue these communities. It's just because whenever you make a school boundaries decision, it's not going to be a decision that you're going to be happy about, because someone has to go to a different school and someone's life gets disrupted by whatever you're doing, and no one makes one of the decisions and is happy about it. Usually higher income communities are able to be more active in these decisions, and in order to go against that requires something that's really hard to ask of county board members. And that's all I was doing in my article, was asking for that, I guess.
Scott, I just want to make a comment. I appreciate what Matthew is saying, and I know that that was not his intent. His intent is only to provide information and thoughts for all of us to continue to improve. But I need to make this point. When I was PTA president at Jefferson, we had a $15,000 budget. It still has a $15,000 budget. We don't always spend that money every year. Other schools have larger budgets. Those are ancillary to the core investment that we make in every school. And I'm going to go back to the point. At $19,000 a student, you should be demanding that every single school, every single child gets what they need, and they do. So that is ancillary money. And when people start comparing Jamestown's PTA budget versus Drew's PTA budget, I'm sorry. It's nice. It's fine. But that's not my job. My job is to make sure every child gets what they need, and they do. And I thank you again for that. And I also have to say that this constant harping and comparison on low-income students, it has an effect on the thinking of those students who feel like they're being told that they're not as good as other students. And we have to deal with that. This is a real conversation. That's why I prefer to say that every student brings great assets to every school. We meet them where they are, and they graduate. 97% graduation rate. So I have to acknowledge that, because it may not be the intent to say that these students, they need more. They're kind of like, well, we have to do something about that. In Arlington, that is not the case. Every student brings strengths, and we invest money with every single student to get them where they need to go.
All right.